you were basically assigned two texts to read from the handout. So I'll briefly talk about those texts. They were from the unofficial biography of Steve Jobs. And the two chapters that we were given were, the first one was Scully and the second one was Different. So basically these two chapters covered two different eras in Steve Jobs' life. The first being when he was still a part of Apple during 1984, and then after that when he was exiled kind of, and then he came back to Apple to take control. So we're going to focus on two ad campaigns that were created during these two eras and how was the politics of representation as a technique was used in these ad campaigns. So the ad campaign in 1984 was created by Ridley Scott. All of you must have heard of him. So the ad went something like this. So there are kind of drones, similarly dressed people who are viewing and who are taking directives from an authority on a screen, and they are moving in a file. They're very controlled in a manner, and they are seen as not having any emotions. So while this is happening, a girl in colored clothes, she comes running in and she throws a hammer at the screen, after which the screen explodes. And then this message appears on screen. On January 24th, Apple Computer will introduce Macintosh, and you will see why 1984 won't be like 1984. So here the reference is being made to George Orwell's novel 1984, in which the society was a dystopia. And Apple, what it's trying to say here is that after the launch of Macintosh, this won't happen. So now I'll analyze this using the symbolic technique. So the ad doesn't talk anything about the product that they're launching. And the mechanical workers in the ad, they are symbolic of the consumerism that was prevalent in that time in the society. And then the directing authority was symbolic of big corporations like IBM, specifically referred to IBM. And the woman represents Apple's Macintosh computer. And by bringing in the woman, they're telling that after the Macintosh is launched, you won't have to be a part of convention, and you will actually have the choice to choose from different. You can select your own computer. So one more aspect is that this ad was aired during the Super Bowl. So at that time there was Cold War going on between the East and the West. So the Western philosophy was based more upon individualism. And so this ad clearly promotes individualism as it gives the consumers the option to select what they want, and it portrays Apple having that kind of that kind of values and that kind of culture. So basically the ad portrays that the consumers, by associating with Apple, they can have that kind, they can be represented as individualistic, and they would then want to be associated with Apple. The second ad campaign was a Think Different ad campaign. Most of you must have seen the campaign. So what's done is very simple. Great historical figures are shown on screen, and then a voiceover goes along with the video. I'm sure you can read this. Finally, after the voiceover, the screen, it is followed by a colorful Apple logo in the end, and before that the screen says Think Different. So basically what Apple is trying to portray is that the great people and shown in the advertisement are symbolic of Apple's greatness, and the entire ad is placed in a black and white format, when in the end a colorful Apple logo appears, which kind of signifies that these were people of the past, and now Apple is the future, and and it is something different, and it is a collection of all of these. So all of these people are from different domains. So some were scientists, some were artists, and some were other great thinkers, some were social activists. So the commercial uses viewers' respect for historical figures to generate positive brand image for itself. So this was the second ad. So now I will go on to explain the first example in managerial context, which is the Complete Man ad campaign from Raymond. So there are a few images of from the ad campaign. There were a lot more, but I could only get these ones. So this one tells us something about friendship. The next one says, even if you are in a corporate culture, you can basically, you're still down to earth, you can play with friends. Then the third image shows an old age home where a guy wearing a suit connects an old man to his family using the internet, and they're basically chatting over the internet. You are taking care of a child. The next one is about managing relationships, and the last one is about you taking your mom along with you when you're being hosted somewhere abroad. So what all of these represent, especially in a country like India, wherein a great emphasis is laid on values, ethics and principles. So the nothing about the suits is being talked about in the ad, but only a man wearing a suit is seen in the ad, and in the end the message comes, the complete man, Raymond, the complete man. So basically Raymond is trying to portray itself as an entity which possesses all of these values and principles. So the values being shown in the ad are symbolic of what Raymond represents. And it's very interesting to know that these ads have evolved with time, and the previous ads were somewhat different from what they're showing now. But the basic theme is same, which is based upon values and ethics and principles. But they are evolving to the culture in different times. And they leave, in all of these examples, they leave the interpretation open for audience, whatever they can interpret, but it's usually something that the audience desires. So now Sai will take you to the next example, and then he'll derive the technique that he
So the second example, the youth is that of the Marlboro Man. I'm guessing most of you know the Marlboro Man campaign. It's actually a very famous ad campaign, and had to do with, you know, overturning slumping cigarette sales in the 1950s. So before we start off, I'd just like to give you a brief overview of what the industry is like. You know, actually the products are pretty much undifferentiated. The taste of cigarettes is pretty much the same. You know, it comes down to a minor variation and a very irrational customer loyalty in the industry. So how do you differentiate in such an environment? You know, the exchange value, the market price of cigarette is going to be the same. What you have to do is you have to appeal to the aesthetics of, you know, the people who are smoking. You have to add an intangible component, an intangible value to whatever is the brand that you're trying to sell. So that is what the Marlboro campaign did very successfully. And what was the campaign? Basically they tried to make the Marlboro Man a symbol in the US for everything that they thought that smoking should stand for. And the way they went about it was changing the entire brand perception of Marlboro as a whole. Marlboro before 1950s was actually a women's cigarette. It was actually, you know, men considered it to be effeminate if they smoked it. And it was only in the 1950s when, you know, the first research regarding cancer, the relation between cancer and smoking came out, that, you know, people began to wonder if Marlboro was actually a better alternative because it was milder and probably had lesser tobacco. So the way they went about it was by introducing filters, and this led to an even further downfall where I think the market share went down to like 20% or something. And they considered it to be effeminate even more. So in the late 1950s, what these guys did was they came up with a completely new brand package and a completely new brand campaign where they targeted only men. How they went about it was by appealing to the pride of, you know, World War veterans. What they did was they used to show Navy SEALs, they used to show cowboys, they used to show all classic American, you know, stereotypes, basically. And they used to appeal to their finer senses. So the box, which had the classic flip-top, which is now, you know, so common in the world, and similarly the classic red that they used in the Marlboro box, it all became a symbol of membership for everybody who smoked it. And it led to an increase in sales of almost, I think, 300%. It tripled their sales. So they had a market share of around 60% in the mid-1960s. So this further evolved as, you know, they began to zone in. What they did was they began to fine-tune their campaign. Initially, the Marlboro Man, you know, they used to show a Navy guy, they used to show a rancher, a flyer, and so many different people. And then as they kept showing the advertisements, they realized that, okay, I'll find a cowboy, something that really works. And that was how the concept of the final Marlboro Man came about. What they did when they introduced it was actually run an 8-page feature in Life magazine, where they spoke about not the brand, not the cigarettes, but the life of the cowboy. And in the end, they spoke about the cigarette. And the way it was done was that, you know, it appealed to men and made them realize that, okay, I'm fine, I want to have a life like this guy. I don't want to live my life, I want to live like a cowboy. So, you know, it made people who started smoking Marlboro feel like, okay, I'm at least, you know, emulating the cowboy in a little way at least. And, you know, that was how the campaign was successful. And gradually over a period of time, 1970s and 1980s, the Marlboro Man, you know, became a symbol in himself. Nobody, you know, you could just put a cowboy on a billboard and people would say that, ah, that's Marlboro Man. So it was a great success. And for our communication technique, we've come up with something called symbolic romanticism. It's really not a big deal. We've just taken all the learnings from, you know, the Apple campaign, from the Marlboro campaign, and the Raymond's The Complete Man campaign. So basically, how does it work? Symbolism works best when it's intangible. You know, you give a cultural value to it more than an exchange value. So that's the first thing. And then secondly, state an ideal state. You know, people are always more attractive when, you know, you're talking about ideals than about reality. So that was the second thing, and that is where the romanticism comes in. And thirdly, yeah, make it more than just the sum of its attributes. The Apple computer is just a computer, you appeal to the lifestyle. Similarly, it's just an ordinary cigarette, but you're appealing to a lifestyle again. So you make it more than the sum of its attributes. And be different. At a time when, you know, for example, Dunhill and, you know, Camel cigarettes and all, you know, they kept on denying claims about cancer and about, you know, cigarettes being harmful for health. What Marlboro did was they said, yes, we are harmful, but we come up with filters, and, you know, it's an indulgence, and what is not simple and fun at the same time. So, you know, you have to be different in some way or the other. And then, yeah, legitimization takes time. The Apple Think Different campaign ran for 7 years. And similarly, even the Marlboro campaign is ran for close to 30 years. So it takes time to reinforce the message. It takes, change does not happen overnight. It takes time for legitimization to happen. And yeah, we need to adapt to cultural variations. As Aditya rightly pointed out, the Raymond's Man, you know, it's adapted over a period of time to, you know, whatever is in vogue at that particular moment in time. So what we've done is Steve Ballmer and the Microsoft Surface. I'm guessing a lot of you know what Microsoft Surface is, so I'm not going to get into it. But basically, if you've seen any of the ad campaigns on TV, they have dancing girls and dancing men, and what they do is, you know, they keep rolling the tablet around and they just keep dancing with it. So it's been a massive flop. People have absolutely hated the perception that it creates among consumers. You know, sales. Recently, there was a report about how 350,000 units are lying unsold in Microsoft's inventory, and so on and so forth. So basically, it's a contradiction between what Microsoft really is and what they're trying to portray themselves as. They're trying to show themselves as a company that is cool, whereas, you know, when we think of Microsoft, we think of Office and we think of, you know, enterprise and all the uncool things that we do at work, and not, you know, an actual lifestyle company. So the advice that we have for Steve Ballmer is to use our technique. Basically, the thing is, when they announced the Surface, they had a really cool teaser video in which they showed the way it was made. It was made from a single block of metal, and, you know, they overplayed the powerfulness, the masculinity of it. And there was at one time there was a YouTube comment at the top which basically said that, okay, this is how I like my technology to be, and that's the ideal that you want to strive for. So, you know, for the intangible, the cold efficiency of metal, you know, like how the teaser showed, and the ideal, the power of a PC. You know, everybody wants a tablet form factor, but a PC's power. So that's the ideal that you want to strive for. And then, yeah, you know, iPad is, you know, the market leader, so put yourself as the underdog, and everybody loves an underdog, you know, so play up to that emotion and make it a lifestyle statement, and finally, repetition, repetition, and repetition. Thank you.